a top expert in the vestibular system, and he will address the oculomotor system. Thank you very much, Michael.
Thank you, my friend Herman. Goedemorgen. Good morning. Buenos dias. Salam aleikum. Bonjour, mesdames et messieurs. Namaste. Did I miss anything? Dobre utre, I think I missed. And buongiorno. So I realized that there are participants from 44 countries, and therefore I would first of all thank Herman for organizing this event in a very professional and instructive way. Actually, we got a lot of instruction how to give nice lectures. And I would also like to thank Automatrix for bringing all the people here from all continents together. And in general, I do appreciate Automatrix's successful efforts to increase your knowledge and improve your skills very much, because this is our future. This is not related to any product, but this is related to your knowledge and skills, so that you can transfer what you hear today and tomorrow into your practice right away on Monday. This is the reason I think we are here. And the first presentation I'm giving today is on oculomotor disorders. And I would like to give you first an overview of the different topics and the aims of my presentation, so that you have a kind of roadmap in your mind. What are you going to expect? First of all, why you are here and listening to this lecture for 1 hour? Maybe you might have gone to the Rice Museum, which is much more interesting. So therefore, I'd like to convince you that it's clinically really relevant that you examine eye movements for at least two purposes. Secondly, what many doctors are afraid of is the anatomy of the oculomotor system. Oh, it looks very difficult. It's really a little bit difficult at first glance, but at second glance, you will see that there are just 5 centers in the brainstem which are relevant, just 5. And I will break it down to simple clinical rules and take home message for you that you can make a precise topographic anatomical diagnosis. And you understand what you're examining and why you examine saccades or smooth pursuit or gaze holding function. The third part is also related to our hands-on course, how to examine the different types of eye movements. And this all should end up first with a specific topographic anatomical diagnosis. This means you should know whether this is brainstem or whether this is cerebellum. And if it's brainstem, you will know this is midbrain, pons, or medulla, because we have very specific signs to make a precise topographic anatomical diagnosis. So that's the first part of the presentation. The second part is going to deal with the different types of nystagmus. And this is going to be a very systematic approach, so that you also know the different types of nystagmus and only the relevant ones, because there are only 5 relevant types of nystagmus. Everything is really rare. What is often neglected, and that's my third topic, are cerebellar eye movement disorders, or even cerebellar nystagmus. And I try to enlighten you on this topic because it's clinically really relevant. Otherwise, you miss the diagnosis in many of the patients who come with persisting dizziness. And the final part is dealing with the application of what you have learned on how to differentiate acute peripheral from acute central, because the key to this diagnosis is the examination of eye movements. So one reason why you should examine eye movements, in particular in patients with acute vertigo, is to learn to differentiate an acute peripheral from a central lesion. And the diagnosis of a central vestibular disorder is a diagnosis by a falsification of a peripheral disorder. Sounds theoretical, but this is the formal logical approach. Many of you probably know the famous Austrian English philosopher Karl Popper, and he said a falsification is possible, but not a verification. Therefore, from a formal logical point of view, you have to falsify a peripheral lesion to diagnose central vertigo. And this is easy because the majority of central vestibular disorders are accompanied by central oculomotor disorders, and you have to have a specific look at them. And the second reason I already briefly mentioned why it's important to examine eye movements is what's behind persisting dizziness. We have a big dizziness unit. We see about 5,000 patients in Munich per year with dizziness. We have 100 people who work in the field, and we can easily do epidemiological studies. And we picked out 5,400 patients with dizziness, and it turned out that more than 450, almost 10% of these patients had what we call cerebellar dizziness. And this had not been diagnosed because the patient's eye movements had not been examined, because this is the cue to the diagnosis of central cerebellar dizziness. So let's get started with the difficult part, the anatomy. And before I do so, a short question. What is the aim of all eye movements? To keep the image of the visual surrounding stable on the retina under different conditions. While fixating, while walking, while turning the head, while following a target, while following a train, while fixating a target far away or near. So the aim is to keep the image of the visual surrounding stable on the retina under different conditions. And therefore, we have so many different types of eye movements. And the anatomy looks at first glance a little bit complex, but what is relevant for patients with vertigo and dizziness are the key structures in the brainstem and the cerebellum. And the type of eye movements which are caused by a dysfunction of these structures is called supranuclear. Easy to explain, it's on top of the oculomotor nuclei, and therefore it's called supranuclear. Secondly, these types of eye movements always affect both eyes, not only one eye, which has an abducens palsy. So both eyes are affected. If you have a saccadic smooth, this will affect both eyes. And as you see, there are just a few centers which are relevant for the topographic anatomical diagnosis. What is not relevant are cortical lesions. This is similar to the vestibular cortex, clinically not relevant. The same is true for the cortical, frontal, and parietal eye fields, clinically not relevant. What is the approach? We need a sound.
Yeah.
We had a sound, but no, we don't have a sound. And now we don't have a projection here. Okay, let's try again.
No. He's looking at you, kid.
Okay, so this is your approach. When you examine patients, this is a not very romantic way to, but politically correct. The German translation is much better.
No. Ich sehe dir in die Augen, Kleines.
Okay, I look in your eyes. So this is much better than the politically correct original version by Humphrey Bogart. So this is the approach. And that's the way you diagnose your patients properly. So let's move on. What type of eye movements do you know? Questions? Nobody should lose his or her face. Any question? What? Fast movements. They're called saccades. It's a French term, saccade. When you ride a horse, you do a saccade. So it comes from a French term, saccades, quick eye movements. Any other? Smooth pursuit is a slow eye movement. Anything else? What? Vergence, near and far away target. Optokinetic nystagmus. The optokinetic nystagmus actually consists of two types of eye movements. What is it? Smooth pursuit and saccades. So if you examine the optokinetic nystagmus, it's a very elegant way to examine simultaneously two types of eye movements, horizontally and vertically. Any other types of eye movements? Vestibular ocular reflex. Did you ever feel your vestibular ocular reflex? You will do it in a few moments. Before you close your eyes, please follow my instructions. So you have to close your eyes exactly and then move your head to the right. Everybody, please. Small exercise. So you can literally feel your vestibular ocular reflex. So, and another way is fixation. Fixation is more than doing nothing. Fixation is to avoid other eye movements. Because if you have a fixation problem, you get square wave jerks, or ocular flutter, or opsoclonus. Then you have a problem with fixation. So now look at this healthy subject. What type of eye movement is she doing? saccades, horizontal saccades. And now, vertical saccades, smooth pursuit. You see smooth pursuit. It's really smooth. If you examine the patient, you should not go too far, otherwise you mix it up with a gaze-evoked nystagmus. And here, now you see optokinetic nystagmus. So this is a combination of smooth pursuit and saccades. And it's a very elegant way to examine children. They're not always very compliant. Or patients with reduced consciousness, or patients with dementia. And if you don't have an optokinetic nystagmus, this indicates either smooth pursuit deficit and or a saccade deficit horizontally and vertically. It's also an important examination in the emergency room. Imagine a patient comes in, drowsy, and you have a normal vertical and horizontal smooth pursuit. Then you can be quite sure that the brainstem is intact at the moment of the examination, because horizontal eye movements are generated where? In the pons. And vertical eye movements in the midbrain. One take-home message for the rest of your life as a medical doctor. Vertical eye movements in the midbrain, horizontal eye movement in the pons. And if you have intact smooth pursuit, horizontally and vertically, plus intact saccades, tested by the optokinetic nystagmus, you can be sure that the brainstem is intact and the patient does not have, at the moment of your examination, a severe basilar thrombosis. So, what is that? Fixation and gaze holding function. So tonight, after three glasses of Belgian beer, your smooth pursuit is going to be saccadic and also your gaze holding function impaired. And why? I'm going to explain you later. So, to summarize the different types of eye movements which should be systematically examined, you have saccades, very quick eye movements, up to 700 degrees per second. They are ballistic, driven by neurons either in the midbrain, I'll tell you the details later, or in the pons. Then we have smooth pursuit, when you follow a target, gaze holding and gaze holding function, vergence eye movements, vestibular ocular reflex, and optokinetic nystagmus. Now a short question. Which of these eye movements are voluntary? Different opinions. Which are voluntary from South Africa? Saccades, but not all of the saccades. They're also reflexive saccades. But vergence saccades and saccades are voluntary. And the rest, and the others, and all the others are reflexive. Keep that in mind. So nobody can perform voluntary smooth pursuit. Yeah? You follow a target with your eyes. And how this works, I'm going to explain that. So it's all done without the cortex, except voluntary saccades. Okay, so now I was already mentioning that there are just a few centers in the brainstem which are relevant for the oculomotor system. And when it comes to real centers, it's just four. And the first one has an incredibly long name. It has been described in humans by Jean Butner-Annever, our neuroanatomist. And it's called the rostral interstitial nucleus of the medial longitudinal rostral interstitial nucleus of the medial longitudinal fascicle, RIMLF. So that's a very long term, and I'll talk about this structure a little bit more detail in a few moments. And there are the neurons which generate vertical saccades. In other words, if you have an isolated vertical saccade palsy, you can make a very specific topographic diagnosis. It's in the upper midbrain. It's in the RIMLF. And the analogous structure in the pons for horizontal saccades is the perimedian pontine reticular formation, PPRF. If the saccades are impaired to the left, you can assume that there is a left PPRF lesion. Very precise. Then we have two other structures, one named after this famous Spanish neuroanatomist Ramon Cajal. It's the interstitial nucleus of Cajal. What is the function of this structure, or the major function? Any ideas? Oh, you're going to have a very steep learning curve. It's the gaze-holding center for vertical eye movements, so-called neural integrator, and this keeps your eyes up and down if you look upward and downward. That's a major function. It has more function, but it's a major clinical function. And the analogous structure for horizontal gaze hold function is the nucleus prepositus hypoglossi. Very simple, crystal clear functional neuroanatomy. So, the general rule is vertical eye movements in the midbrain, horizontal eye movements in the pons. Secondly, to be more specific, vertical saccades in the RIMLF, vertical gaze holding function and also torsional in the INC, and the analogous structures PPRF for horizontal saccades and nucleus prepositus hypoglossi, in cooperation, of course, with the cerebellum for horizontal gaze holding. That's it. And now let's move on to pathological anatomy. Look at the saccades of this patient. How are they? What is your impression? Normal or too slow? Too slow. Where's the site of the lesion? Midbrain, pons, cerebellum, cortex? Midbrain. Where in the midbrain? Okay. RIMLF. Look at this patient here. What type of nystagmus? Just describing eye movements is describing eye movements, nothing else. What do you see? What are the eyes doing? How do you call this movement? Convergence. Convergence, retraction nystagmus. This also indicates a lesion in the upper midbrain, which affects most often the posterior commissure. The posterior commissure, commissura posterior, connects both RIMLF, and if this is impaired, you get this specific oculomotor sign. So if you see a patient with a convergent retraction nystagmus, there's only one area in the brain which can lead to that. This is a lesion of the posterior commissure, or a bilateral RMF lesion, but this is very rare. Okay, now have a look at this patient here. He's looking upward. He has a complex oculomotor finding, a skew deviation, an exotropia. If he looks upward, in which direction are the quick face of the nystagmus beating? The quick face is upward. Now he's looking downward, and the quick face is beating downward. So first of all, it's a vertical direction changing nystagmus. So a vertical gaze evoked nystagmus. Where's the site of the lesion? INC. So it makes a lot of fun, by the way, to examine patients' eye movements because you make a really exact diagnosis. Okay, now look at this lady here. This was taken with my smartphone. She has to look upward and downward. Can you identify any pathological finding? What is she doing when she has to perform vertical saccades? She's blinking, so you cannot properly examine her. Is there a strategy to do so? Yes, of course. This is something we have some exercises on tomorrow. So, look what's happening when she lifts her upper eyelids. What type of eye movements is she? It's called walking around the house. If you see that, you can make not only a topographic anatomical, but also an etiological diagnosis of a treatable disease. So you should not miss it. So this is a severe impairment of vertical saccades. But saccades only. Look at her smooth pursuit. She has a full range of movements. You see, this is not a vertical gaze palsy, as in PSP, but it's an isolated vertical supranuclear saccade palsy. Typical sign of one treatable disease, affecting primarily and firstly the RIMLF. And here again another patient. Look whether this upward or downward saccades are more impaired. Is it more upward or downward? What is slower? Downward. So typical, because we have for the upward saccades a double innervation, and for the downward saccades a single innervation. Therefore, often downward and then upward. are impaired. Any ideas about the diagnosis? You should know that disease. Otherwise, you miss patients, children, young adults with a treatable inherited metabolic disorder. What is it? NPC. Michael, you're right. We see a lot of NPC patients. We have a collection of about 50 patients, and we do a lot of studies in them. So 95% of these patients, and therefore I mentioned that, it's not an issue if you miss a non-treatable disease, but it's a big issue if you will miss a treatable disease. And for NPC, the clinical sign, which already occurs at the age of 1 or 2 years in some affected individuals, is a supranuclear vertical saccade palsy. Normal smooth pursuit, but an impaired saccade palsy. It's first downward, then upward, then horizontal. And to point it out, it's a sensitive and early clinical sign and the key feature of NPC. Easy to diagnose. It's a biomarker for progression. And NPC is treatable with miglustate and, as we recently found out, also with a modified amino acid, acetyl-L-leucine. So keep it in mind. Maybe you see one patient in your lifetime, but you can do him or her a lot of good. Okay, now we were talking about gaze-evoked nystagmus, interstitial nucleus of Cajal, and how does that work? We do have in our brainstem and cerebellum a so-called neural integrator. You were all great in math, I suppose. I like mathematics very much. So what is an integrator doing in the oculomotor system in this context? It's very simple. It integrates the velocity of the eye movements over time. This gives a signal. So if I jump from here to there, the brainstem integrates the velocity over time, and this ends up with a certain action potential frequency, very simple, which keeps the eyes in eccentric position. Now imagine that this integrator is leaky. That's a technical term introduced by David Robinson in the 80s, a very sophisticated engineer who brought mathematics into the oculomotor system. Imagine the integrator is leaky. So we start with 200 hertz, and then it goes down to 150. That means the eyes drive to the position which is required for 150 hertz, and then you jump back, okay? So the idea, and this is proven, for a gaze-holding deficit, for a gaze-evoked nystagmus, is a leaky integrator. And this occurs after alcohol, or with benzodiazepines, or in neurodegenerative diseases. And if it's isolated, vertical, it indicates a dysfunction of the INC. And if you have a close look at the eye movements, you see the velocity is first high and goes down, because then we come closer to the 150 hertz. The driving force decreases. Gaze-evoked nystagmus. Now look at this lady here. Horizontal saccades. How are they? Slow? Hypometric? Hypermetric? More to the left? More to the right? More to the left. Where's the side of the lesion? Cortex, brainstem, cerebellum? Brainstem. Which part of the brainstem? Horizontal saccades? Pons, PPRF. More left than right. This patient unfortunately had a pontine glioma with typical oculomotor findings. And the underlying structure for these eye movements is the paramedian pontine reticular formation, and this is important for ipsilateral horizontal saccades. So we can identify whether it's right or left. That makes a lot of fun. And you're better than your neuroradiologist in these issues. And the same is true for this disease. Very familiar to neurologists. What is it? What do you diagnose? What do you see? Do the eyes move in parallel or not in this patient? Look. The left eye arises later than the right eye. That means the velocity of the left eye is lower than of the right eye. Now look at this patient here. This is not infrequent. It's not, simply not diagnosed. What is that? A bilateral internuclear ophthalmoplegia. If you see that in a patient with acute vertigo, it's central. Clearly indicates a central lesion. And this is one of the rare exceptions, that a central disease affects both eyes in a different way. it's very easy to explain and to understand. I'm just kidding you. It's not that easy. Why do you see it so frequently in multiple sclerosis? Let's start with the easy part. Multiple sclerosis is caused by demyelination, so you need a pathway. And the pathway which is affected is the medial longitudinal fascicle. It's a very long pathway, so the risk is high that it's affected. Secondly, it's periventricular. So these are the reasons why you see it so frequently in MS. But you can also see in a patient above the age of 60 with a lacunar brainstem infarct, also a central sign. Now the question arises, why do you get an impairment of saccades on one side? Let's imagine you would like to do a saccade from the right to the left. The signal comes from the right frontal eye field. This goes down to a structure which you are familiar with, to the PPRF. The PPRF on the left side generates saccades to the left. But you have to do parallel eye movements. So the signal has to go to both eyes. And this is easily driven via the abducens lucius to the ipsilateral eye, which is not affected. But we also have to contract our contralateral medial rectus. And this is driven by the so-called 6-3 projection via interneurons, which run here in the MLF to the contralateral oculomotor nucleus. And if you have a lesion here in this long tract, you will get an impairment of adduction. And that's the clinical sign of the INO, and not the dissociated nystagmus, the impairment of adduction. And finally, the most sensitive test to detect it is not smooth pursuit, but saccades. So you have to have saccades. And in your MS patients, you will see many patients with an INO, which had not been previously diagnosed, if you examine the saccades. So, if you'd like, you can take some slides, because this is a summary of my presentation of the first part. It's about the pathological anatomy of the brainstem. Let's start with the upper brainstem. So we talked about the RIMLF in detail, paresis of vertical saccades. INC, vertical gaze evoked nystagmus, posterior commissural pathways, convergence retraction nystagmus, and finally, which can also occur in the midbrain, MLF lesions, leading to INO. If we move further down, we can also have an MLF lesion. PPRF lesions lead to ipsilateral horizontal saccade palsy and the nucleus praepositus hypoglossi, not to be mixed up with normal pressure hydrocephalus, causes an isolated horizontal gaze evoked nystagmus. I'll talk about the vestibular cerebellum later. So, have a look at this colleague sitting in front of my office. What's he doing? Sleeping. Like many of us during the radiology conferences, we might miss something here or there. Okay, how is that related to our topic? Mm-hmm. Okay, slow phase and a quick phase. By the way, which is the pathological phase? The slow or the fast phase? The slow phase. Nystagmus comes from the Greek term nystatsein, which means getting drowsy, falling asleep. If you do so, you will make these movements. And the pathological phase, similar and identical to nystagmus, is the slow phase. The slow phase moves the head downward. The slow phase of the eye movements drives the eyes away from the point of fixation. So that's the pathological phase. The quick phase brings the eyes back. But since you can identify the quick phase easier, the direction is given according to the quick phase. This is similar to the magnetic and geographic north and south pole. It's not logical, but it's just definition. We have to live with it. Okay, so slow phase, quick phase. Spontaneous nystagmus. That's frequent. How is a spontaneous nystagmus defined? What is it? We often use this term, but not everybody might be aware of its specific meaning. It occurs when you look straight ahead in the primary position. This is a spontaneous nystagmus. Then we have two types of spontaneous nystagmus. One is called the peripheral vestibular spontaneous, and the other one is called the central fixation nystagmus. What's the difference? Important for you. Maybe you put it the other way. what's happening with the spontaneous nystagmus of peripheral if you fixate? You suppress it. So that's a feature. Visual suppression, visual fixation suppression, similar to visual fixation suppression of the VOR. This goes hand in hand. I'll show that later. Visual fixation suppression of the nystagmus. That's a key feature of a peripheral vestibular spontaneous nystagmus, whereas a fixation nystagmus is present although the patient is fixating. So this is the key feature. And then we have other forms, gaze evoked, and about 50 different other forms. Neurological examination. So you need a device to prevent visual fixation. So there are three ways to examine patients for nystagmus. First, with fixation, simply looking straight out. Look for a gaze-evoked nystagmus, looking to the right and to the left. We do the exercises tomorrow in the hands-on course. With and without fixation. Without fixation, you can use the M-classes. And all patients should be examined by the positioning maneuvers. Look, this is the regular one, 500 gram, 500 euro. Here you see a patient fixating, and here with the other classes, and thereby can identify peripheral vestibular spontaneous nystagmus. And the American Academy of Neurology was quite convinced about the tool that they put it on the cover page of the September edition of Neurology. Okay, so now let's have a look at a patient. Do you see a nystagmus? Do you see it now? Okay. Think a moment before you answer. What is it? A peripheral or a central fixation nystagmus? It's a peripheral vestibular spontaneous nystagmus in an acute unilateral vestibulopathy. Another thing which you should remember for the rest of your life, the nystagmus always beats in the direction of the more active labyrinth, the quick phase. Okay? Direction. So in this patient, the left labyrinth was more active. He had an acute unilateral vestibulopathy on the right side. Now this patient here, she also has a nystagmus, and she'd like to suppress the nystagmus, but is not able to do so. So this is a typical central fixation nystagmus. By the way, what are her symptoms in addition to others? Oscillopsia. Who of you ever had oscillopsia? Can you raise your hand? Okay, yeah. During your legendary experiment. For those who didn't have, please do the very simple test. Cover one eye. And now press with the tip of the index finger on the lower eyelid of the other eye with a frequency of 2 to 3 hertz. Press really on the eyeball. What do you see? Images jumping. Do you like that? Probably not. What is going to happen after 5 minutes doing so? You're getting nausea and vomiting, like Mikhail did during this experiment. So you have visual vertigo. And this is what these patients suffer from, and they're severely impaired. So, now, what is the signal that we use to suppress a nystagmus? Actually, that's important for you. It's the same signal that we use for smooth pursuit. It's the same signal that we use for visual fixation suppression of the VOR. What is the signal? It's retinal slip. This tiny movement of the visual surrounding on the retina. That's the driving force. That's the error signal to suppress a nystagmus. That's the driving force, the signal for smooth pursuit. Smooth pursuit is never 100%. You follow a target, retinal slip. And this explains easily why you have different types of nystagmus. If your central nervous system is perfectly intact, you can use retinal slip to suppress your nystagmus. This is what you use to suppress your VOR. It's identically the same, because the brain does not know if you spin around or if the other labyrinth is not working. For the brain, it makes no difference. So the same signal is used to suppress the VOR and to suppress a peripheral vestibular spontaneous nystagmus. Whereas, if you have a central problem, you will not be able to use the signal. So that's the key difference between A and B. Keep that in mind. The same signal used physiologically for smooth pursuit, physiological for suppression of the VOR, and pathologically to suppress or even not able to be suppressing the nystagmus. Here are other different types of nystagmus. Look at this lady. She had an acquired fixation pendular nystagmus, one of the types we cannot treat. Look at this lady here. She looks straight ahead. You don't see it, but now when she looks to the right and to the left, what is it? The most frequent type of nystagmus? Downbeat nystagmus. It's treatable with 4-aminopyridine, as we have already shown in 2003. So there are different types of nystagmus. Here's another one. I could show you about 50 different videos, but I just have 1 hour. What is it? Seesaw nystagmus. It's often associated with an impairment of the visual system. We don't know exactly the pathophysiology, but we know this patient here has a congenital nystagmus. This is due to the problem of the cerebellum. We did a voxel-based morphometry study on congenital nystagmus, which is very frequent, and we found areas in the cerebellum which are not working properly and leading to this fixation problem. Okay, so many types of nystagmus. Don't want to show them all, but I'd like to show you this table. Then you see what is relevant. So what you should know is downbeat nystagmus, upbeat nystagmus, central positioning nystagmus, pendular nystagmus, and which is now called infantile nystagmus, not congenital. So these are the frequent types. Everything else quite rare. Okay, now we have something which looks like nystagmus. But what is it? Do you see a quick and a slow face? Ocular flutter, that's it. So these, in a strict sense of meaning, are no types of nystagmus. And this is a more severe form, it's called. You see it in autoimmune ZNS diseases. I don't like the term paraneoplastic anymore because the vast majority we now know are not paraneoplastic. This is opsoclonus. So in a strict sense, this is ocular flutter, opsoclonus, and it's called saccadic oscillations or intrusions. So these are very quick saccades, and the patients have a problem with their so-called omnipause neurons, which prevent saccades. So there's a disinhibition of certain neurons by antibodies, for instance, and therefore they have these saccadic oscillations. And you see eyes open, eyes closed is a major difference. Okay, now we move over to a evidently very difficult area. Many neurologists are very concerned about the cerebellum, and there are big books, 1,500 pages, which are justified, because in the cerebellum you have more neurons than in the brain. What is the basic function of the cerebellum? Control, that's good, yeah, fine. It's inhibition. Because the only output from the cerebellum goes via Purkinje cells. These are the key cells, and the transmitter of Purkinje cells is GABA. So it's inhibition. It's like the brake of your car, of your bicycle, whatever. If your brake is not working properly, you will move too far, or you will have a problem with precise driving, and this leads to ataxia. This also looks very complicated. Cerebellum and eye movements. We have the vermis, we have the flocculus, and the nodulus. Forget about the nodulus. Almost forget about the vermis, but do not forget the flocculus. 95% of all cerebellar oculomotor dysfunction, and you're familiar with many terms, are due to dysfunction of the flocculus. Flocculus and paraflocculus are the key structures which lead to these dysfunction. And here you see it specifically. So, if you have a smooth pursuit deficit, an impaired VOR suppression, a Gazy-Voigt nystagmus in all directions, and downbeat nystagmus, a rebound nystagmus, this is all due to a dysfunction of the flocculus, which means cloud, if you translate it, okay? Of minor relevance are the vermis and the fastigial nucleus, and less relevant are nodulus. I talk now about the flocculus. And many things you know, you can now attribute to the flocculus. You see, saccadic smooth pursuit, more to the left than to the right. So she has a flocular lesion more on the left than on the right side. It's always ipsiversa. This patient here, look at him. Severe impairment of smooth pursuit. He has a neurodegenerative cerebellar disorder leading to bilateral dysfunction of the flocculus with saccadic smooth pursuit. Another test I had been talking about was visual fixation suppression of the VOR. You see on the left side a healthy subject, and on the right side someone with a multiple sclerosis. And she also has an impairment of visual fixation suppression of the VOR. This goes hand in hand with the smooth pursuit deficit. It's the same signal she cannot use, retinal slip. This is a very sensitive test for a cerebellar dysfunction, so do not miss to do that, and we are going to do some exercise tomorrow on that. So there are different types of cerebellar nystagmus, and since time flies, who is aware of a cerebellar nystagmus? Who knows a cerebellar nystagmus? at least six, as you see. Cerebellar nystagmus. I was thinking about it half a year ago, and I realized it's not very popular, but it's clinically relevant. Look here. Downbeat nystagmus, gaze evoked nystagmus in all directions, rebound nystagmus, central positioning nystagmus, periodic alternating and cross-coupling nystagmus. This is all cerebellar. I'll show you the videos tomorrow during my course, and then you can identify the patients. So to summarize this up, the key structure is flocculus. Thirdly, for the rest of your medical life, if someone is asking you about cerebellum and eye movements, just say flocculus, you're already 95%. You sound like an expert, and you are an expert. So you can break it down to that. Okay, now we have something here. Look at the saccades. How are they? Hypermetric. This is a clear cerebellar sign, but not arising from the flocculus, I'm afraid. So this is hypermetric. They go too far. And now look at this very rare case here on the right side. How are her saccades? Maybe you see a few patients in your lifetime only. How are they? Hypometric. This is very exceptional, but nevertheless, since it's so interesting, I'll show it to you. And this is caused by, very easy to explain, a dysfunction of the vestigial nucleus, which leads to hypermetric saccades. And now you see the structures you are familiar with, and the circle closes. You have the RIMLF and you have the PPRF. And the cerebellum determines not the velocity, this is done by these centers, but the accuracy of saccades. And the vestigial nucleus normally inhibits these structures. If the brake is not working properly, you drive too far, the saccades go too far. So you have hypermetric saccades. And now, the vestigial nucleus is also inhibited by other neurons, which are in the dorsal vermis. That means a lesion of the dorsal vermis leads to a disinhibition of the vestigial nucleus, generating hypometric saccades. And for you to memorize, dorsal vermis hypometric, double O, okay? Dorsal vermis hypometric saccades, vestigial hypermetric. So that's all about the cerebellum and eye movements. If you like, you can take a photograph of this slide and take it with you. Put it on top of your examination desk, and then you make a better diagnosis. So, what's behind dizziness? This is what I meant when we had a look at cerebellum. It's very important. And now the final part, how to differentiate between acute, peripheral, and central vertigo by means of the big five. That means you can apply what you have learned during the last 40 minutes. We should always be afraid of patients with these lesions. They come with acute vertigo. They look like acute unilateral vestibulopathy. By the way, the new term for vestibular neuritis. So use acute unilateral vestibulopathy in the future. But they have an MS plaque. They have a brainstem encephalitis and most frequently an infarction. If you have a look at the detailed anatomy, what are the structures affected which can lead to that? Just a few in the brainstem. Here is staining, a Nissl staining. And relevant are the vestibular nuclear neurons and the root entry zone of the eighth nerve. They can lead to a vestibular pseudoneuritis, but associated with central oculomotor disorder. So it's a very tiny structure in the brainstem. But there's also a tiny structure in the cerebellum, which can induce symptoms and signs which look like vestibular neuritis. Here, a structure you're familiar with, the flocculus, and also parts of the vermis, because they directly project to the vestibular nuclei. Inhibition leading, a lesion leads to a disinhibition. So it looks like vestibular neuritis, but it's due to a cerebellar lesion. How do you differentiate? You just apply the so-called, what I call, the big five. It's not hunting in, or game park hunting in South Africa with Marie. So, eye position, nystagmus, smooth pursuit, gaze holding, VOR function. And we quickly go through that. The first thing is eye position. And you have to look for a so-called vertical divergence, one eye above the other. And the most elegant test to do so, and this is the first thing I always do in patients with acute vertigo, is the cover test, specifically the alternating cover test. You might see that the left eye is a little bit above the right eye, but if you do the alternating cover test, you will clearly see how the eyes are jumping in a few seconds. So the left eye goes down, the right eye goes up. If you see that in a patient with acute vertigo, it's most likely central and you can stop your examination. So vertical divergence, Q deviation, alternating cover test. We do exercises on that tomorrow. You find it, however, only in 30% of patients with brainstem infarction, not in all of them. But if you see it, it is central. So that's the first sign, skew deviation, vertical divergence, one component of the ocular tilt reaction. And the other thing you are familiar with is now what type of nystagmus. Do you see a nystagmus in this subject? Can you see something? So now in a very bad situation, you have your Michael's glasses not with you. Plan B is the patient should close his eyes. You also prevent visual fixation. Do you see the nystagmus now? So it's a very elegant test. But this works in the very acute phase only. So this is plan B, okay? So you see, this is a peripheral vestibular spontaneous nystagmus, and all the other patients had a central nystagmus. Another thing you should look at, this is number three, smooth pursuit. Whether it's smooth or saccadic. It's saccadic, the patient has a gaze holding, smooth pursuit deficit, and this indicates a central lesion, in particular if it's in all direction. So number three of the big five, saccadic smooth pursuit. Number four is gaze holding function. Look at the patient, he's now fixating. You see a tiny nystagmus beating to the left, and now he's looking to the right, and you will see a gaze evoked nystagmus to the right. Direction changing nystagmus. That's the key. If the patient looks to the left, you will see the spontaneous nystagmus with a higher intensity according to Alexander's law. This is not going to help. So you have to look in different directions and look for a direction-changing nystagmus. That's the key of the gaze-holding nystagmus. So number four, gaze-evoked nystagmus in the opposite direction of the spontaneous nystagmus. And another thing is, which we already described earlier, acute vertigo, acute nystagmus, and a normal head impulse test. You see here, in the patient on the right, it's pathological to the right, and in the other patient, it's normal. So again, from a formal logical point of view, if you have a patient with acute vertigo, acute nystagmus, and a normal head impulse test, it's most likely central. If it's pathological, it can also be central. Okay? Formal logic. So, to summarize the big five, take a photograph of that. Skew deviation, central fixation nystagmus, saccadic smooth pursuit, direction changing nystagmus opposite to the spontaneous nystagmus, and normal head impulse test. And already in 2008, we summarized that in the first paper on 80 patients. This paper is unfortunately a little bit neglected because we did not use a clever acronym. Nevertheless, we ended up with a sensitivity and a specificity of more than 90% looking at gaze-evoked nystagmus, skew deviation, head impulse set, and saccadic smooth pursuit. And basically, this was only replicated by further studies. No further comment on that. Okay, here again for your take-home photograph, how to examine the patient. We do not have enough time, otherwise I demonstrated that quickly. But we have to have some more videos for the quiz. So take that and put that on top of your examination table. Then you have a systematic way on how to examine your patients. For those who are more interested, we have designed, and this is going also be translated into Spanish and Russian and Arab, a new website. It's called www.neurocular.com. And you see about 100 videos with topographic anatomical diagnosis and so on and so forth. So it's a lot of fun to go through there. Maybe you need, I would need 4 or 5 times. Maybe you can do it with 1 or 2. And finally, I'd like to announce our second international masterclass in Munich. It's November 4th and 5th, 2016. So this is complementary to what you listen to here today and tomorrow. It's more clinically oriented. We have plenary lectures on Friday, and on Saturday we have courses in small groups on imaging, functional imaging, research methods, techniques, rehabilitation, but also hands-on courses, how to examine the patient. Thank you very much for your attention, and now we have to run the video quiz.